The exhibition Ways of Seeing Görme Biçimleri is a big group exhibition bringing together more than 33 artists from all over the world working in diverse media. One of the main themes in the exhibition is to invite visitors to take a second look, to look at an artwork, to maybe think you see something, but then on a second look you realize that the artist is tricking you into something completely different. So you may see things that are actually not there, or you discover things that you didn't see at first.
The exhibition Ways of Seeing is actually an invitation to the viewer to reconsider the role of the artist as a maker of things, as a skilled technician who, through the way in which they handle the physical properties of things and the formalistic strategies that they employ, help us reconfigure our understanding and perception of the world.
All the artworks in the exhibition invite viewers actually to take a direct look, to make a direct contact with the artwork. You know, we find very often that visitors spend maybe 30 seconds looking and reading a wall text, the description about the artwork, but then only spend a few seconds actually engaging and looking at the artwork itself. So we're hoping that this will be a little bit the other way around.
I think also in building on what Till is saying in terms of the viewers taking, being more active or being more engaged, this is something that we also wanted to focus on by looking into what John Berger did in 1972 with his critical text on visual culture, Ways of Seeing, which was also initially a BBC documentary. Through his work, Berger was inviting people or encouraging people to be very, very active in the way they look at art. He kind of moved away the emphasis of art criticism from the art professional, from the critic, from the art historian, from the museum practitioner, and said everybody should be able to make their own connection to art, should be able to look at the artwork, analyze it, interpret it in all sorts of ways and forms. There's not one way of looking at art. And this is, in a sense, the importance of ways of seeing, or different ways of seeing. There are so many different points of view, and it's always important to be reminded that through art, there's so many ways of looking, and there's this existence of so many ways of view, that ways of seeing that are very, very important.
Many of the artists on display are artists that we followed over many, many years. So there are a lot of great examples of pieces that we find extremely exciting and very avant-garde or very seminal in a certain way. And one of the core criteria for putting this show together is to find artists that first and foremost work in a formalistic way. So there are artists that are, in a sense, makers of things. They have a great craft, they have a great skill. They have pushed a certain medium or even pioneered a certain medium, such as James Turrell, for example, who was one of the first artists to actually use light as his main material. This is something you can't touch, you cannot even really see, you can't feel it, but still it is there, and he uses it to create wonderful experiences in spaces. So for us, the exhibition is a return, or we hope that actually it encourages people to see artists first and foremost as individuals who use form, who use techniques to express something about themselves, about the world. I think many times we find now exhibitions that highlight the role of an artist as an activist, maybe, or as an archivist. And sometimes these are works that one wonders if they were better done as a documentary film, or if some of those people write a book. But I think visual art is something that creates poetry and magic, and I think we have a lot of this here in the exhibition. You are intrigued, you don't quite understand what's happening, but it leaves you with a feeling of something that is highly engaging, and this is what we really love about the show.
I also think that something very important about the choice of works and artists is that we wanted to have kind of a panorama of practices representing different disciplines and different media and different genres. So all the artists that Till was talking about have all pushed the boundaries of their own particular discipline, whether it's painting, photography, sculpture, video. So each of these artists is kind of handling the technical and formalistic characteristics of their medium in order to push it forward, in order to employ it in a new way, so that they actually allow us to see things in a different way. And that's something very important. So we wanted to kind of cover all these disciplines. And I think one of the other things that we wanted to emphasize in the exhibition is that what we encounter in terms of how artists work formalistically in contemporary art is not something that just happened or started to happen now. We have work spanning, you know, from 1000 BC all until the present. And what we wanted to say is that this kind of contemporaneity of engagement, of thinking, of doing that artists always, you know, engage in is something that has always been happening throughout history. So from Orientalist paintings that actually frame our gaze of the other, to nationalist, you know, paintings of the 20th century or, you know, before, to even Isnik ceramics from the 16th and 17th century, to ancient maps from Germany and Holland, you know, in the 17th, 18th century. We have a wide array of things, even Anatolian prehistoric figurines dating from the 5th century BC and the 8th century BC. The idea was to show the contemporaneity of art and that these isms and classifications that we have in museums are not necessarily the best way to see the artwork. We try to liberate them from these classifications.
I think one very exciting thing about the exhibition is that we have such a diverse range of artists and artworks that at first may seem really strange in terms of bringing them together into an exhibition. However, what really unites them is this strong idea of, you know, a second look or something that is formalistically making you reassess a certain part of the reality. And I think the case that the exhibition makes very strongly is something that we have always done in our exhibitions. There is a fundamental belief is that humans and artists as such really are the same no matter where they come from at the end of the day. And they are the same no matter if they're working today or a long time ago. Fundamentally, the ideas and how somebody thinks is actually not changing that much over time. It may be the technology or a certain tool, how you can express something that you feel or something that you see, but the fundamental way of thinking and the fundamental approach to our human existence actually is pretty much the same.
As you walk through the exhibition, you will realize that we conceived the show as one comprehensive installation. So it's not like many presentations of different artists sitting next to each other. There are certain works by specific artists in the show that have been scattered over different floors, so they become like points of reference, like landmarks that guide you through the exhibition, connecting the different floors through this kind of visual thread. So Marcus Schönwald, for instance, you see different paintings of his on the three floors. There are also works by Gustav Metzger on the ground floor and on the first floor. And a lot of these choices have to do with certain kind of references or certain similarities that some of these artworks have, hence the reason of why they are placed where they are. So for instance, some artworks look into the absence of the artwork. It's actually the absence of the work that allows us to see it in a new way. So James Webb, for instance, with The Scream, or Vic Moniz by showing us the back of a Picasso painting, or even Walid Raad by showing us the reflection of artworks on the floor rather than the works themselves, all kind of connect to this notion of staging the artwork through the absence of the artwork instead of having the artwork itself on display. You know, there are other works that kind of look at historical references. So you look at James Casbier and how he reinterprets Sea of Ice by Caspar David Friedrich. You have, for instance, the work of Cindy Sherman and how she actually looks at the historical genre of portraiture to deconstruct our, you know, the ways in which we represent women. You have, for instance, Shanna Malton and the way she creates these collages, these sculptures that have a very surrealist kind of departure point, which dialogues beautifully with the Salvador Dali piece that's in the show. So in a sense, there's a lot of dialogues between the works, kind of reflecting all the aesthetic positions and the formalistic strategies that the artists are using in order to kind of allow us to see things in a different way, and hence ways of seeing, which is the main theme of this exhibition.
We have a number of artists in the exhibition that really push the actual medium that they're working with or have been true pioneers. Fred Sandbeck, who is creating invisible planes or invisible spaces that you start thinking that you can actually see them as you're walking around the space, but it is all constructed of threads and it is somehow an illusion of sorts, and you kind of lose yourself in a space almost in a floating kind of sensation. So while some of these installations are very ephemeral, they nonetheless create a very physical effect on the body, and I think this is a really quite remarkable experience, and we're very happy to have these pieces here. One of the pieces in the exhibition by Salvador Dalí, one of the most important members of the Surrealist movement, is a great example for the concept of the exhibition, Ways of Seeing. The Surrealist many times took objects and placed them in unfamiliar contexts. So it is actually something that you know, in this case we have a shoe and various other objects that all of a sudden are regarded as a work of art. They are seen in a context where you would normally not see them and how you would never see them. And this new meaning that is actually bestowed on an object is a great example for this exhibition. We also have a very seminal piece by Paul and Marlene Koss in the exhibition called Lightning. And you see Marlene Koss in a car, and she is looking or trying to see in the background a lightning as a thunderstorm is approaching.
When I look away,
she says that she is trying to see the lightning, but it doesn't strike. And when she looks at the camera, and as such as the viewer in the exhibition, she says, "When I look away, it does." Sometimes the lightning does strike in this moment, sometimes it doesn't. And it's a great play on actually what is the artwork and are things real when you see them? Do you have to see them to believe them? And it's a very, very short but very powerful piece that illustrates the concept of the exhibition in a very great and very immediate way. Another great example in the exhibition are the several pieces by Gustav Metzger, who unfortunately recently passed away. But the pieces require an active participation by the viewer. So the artwork is actually hidden by a curtain, by a yellow cloth on the floor, by certain fabrics that you have to lift to see the drawings. And what it does is actually it confronts the visitor with a bit of a moral dilemma. Do I actually touch it? Do I really go behind it? Do I want to engage with this or not? So there is an element of maybe shame or an element of embarrassment or a physical act that is required to actually access the artwork. And when you do, you realize that some of those images really portray horrific incidents in the history of many countries. So you see scenes of violence or scenes of humiliation, but you can only see a part of that image because you have to hide behind the fabric. You have to physically make an effort to access it, but you can never quite see the full picture. So that is also a metaphor so that one can perhaps never really comprehend the full dimension of the scenes that the artist is actually depicting.
I think another artist in the exhibition that also has a very playful approach, but when you dig deeper beneath the surface, you realize that they're tackling very, very serious issues, is Hassan Sharif, who also unfortunately passed away only a few months ago. So the work that we have on display, Back to School, is a beautiful sculptural piece that hangs on a wall. It's about 3 meters, you know, tall, about 2.5 meters wide. And it's when you look at it, you think it's you don't really make out what the materials are. And then as you get closer to the piece and you start looking, you realize that it's made of backpacks, school children backpacks. And what's interesting is that he actually chose the backpacks to be in two colors, pink and blue, which makes us think of girls and boys, or gender roles and gender assigning, that girls are supposed to carry a pink bag, boys are supposed to carry a blue bag. But then these bags are actually symbols or metaphors for vessels of knowledge. So each of these bags carries the books that we learn from. So they represent the individual and the knowledge that the individual carries. But as he ties them all together, which is in line with his practice at large, this recycling, a lifetime spent in recycling, it kind of makes us realize that we are all connected, that the vessels of knowledge that each of one portrays is actually part of a network of information that is shared by all of us, regardless of our sex, of our gender.
Another great artist in the exhibition is James Caspier, and we're standing actually here next to one of his amazing photographs. And at first, when you come and see these large-scale images, you see a scene of one house or several houses in an idyllic landscape, but you very quickly realize this cannot be real. There's something very eerie about it. And then you quickly discover they're actually staged models. So they're constructed models of a house, of a little neighborhood, you see trees in it, you see all sort of little elements. The lighting is done in a way that it almost creates some kind of ghostly effect. You think it's very eerie and you start to wonder, what's this happening here? Where are the people in it? You almost wonder what is going to happen, or did something happen, but you know that something is not quite real. So it is a staged reality, but one that we connect to immediately, and this creates a certain discomfort that we wonder what is wrong with it and why is it not looking quite the way it is. And I think the absence of people in these images is one of those absolutely core effects that we see very quickly here in the image. A number of artists in the exhibition present objects that are familiar to us but are actually completely altered and have lost their original meaning. One such example is Alicia Quade, for example. We see a clock that looks quite familiar to us. It looks like a generic office clock or something you might see in a train station, but the clock functions in a very, very strange way. The dial for the second is fixed, but the entire clock is actually rotating. So it is a very fun play on what is the center and what is maybe rotating around. So does the dial rotate around the center, or does the clock actually rotate itself? So what is actually fixed and what is not fixed? And it makes a great example of something that is relative, something time is relative, you know, our understanding of time and how we connect and convey information is relative. And what it does actually is a very unsettling thing, because we all need time in our societies to function and to agree and coordinate. And all of a sudden, when that is not working, nothing is working at all anymore, and we're left in a state of limbo and curiosity. Another great example of that is actually Muna Hatoum. Muna Hatoum presents a stick that is made out of a very soft material. It is something that is leaning against the corner, a very small soft piece. But actually, when you think about a crutch, what it means, and you can't use it anymore, confronts you so much actually that it's not maybe doing what you want it to do, but it might make your condition worse. You know, you're trying to use it as a helping aid, but it actually really also marks you as someone that needs a stick, and it might actually wear you down more than it actually helps you in a particular case. We also have another example of crutches in here, but these, however, are done by Shana Moulton. They are funny looking sculptures that are embroidered, there is weaving around them. They look like people almost more than crutches in this case. And there's a whole group in here that is, in a sense, a prequel to her amazing video installation that we also see in the exhibition along with her photographic series. Another great artist is Jeppe Hein. He presents us with a mirror, but the mirror is actually distorted in the middle, and there is a fold. It's only a small angle of a difference, and this mirror is actually slowly rotating around its own axis. And it's the strange effect, actually, that makes this piece so engaging. So things start moving up and down. You see yourself almost like in an elevator going up or down. You see pieces appearing in the back. You see the lightning. You see the floor in a very small kind of passage, in a small symphony almost of images that makes it a really wonderful kinetic installation that completely messes with your sense of what is right and what is left, what is top and bottom. And it definitely gives you a very new way of seeing not only yourself, but yourself in the context of the space that you're in.
One of the videos in the exhibition is a work by David Klarboot. It's called The Algiers Section of a Happy Moment. And it's an amazing piece because when you first walk into the space, you think that you're looking at stills from a video, you know, that kind of exist chronologically in time, as if, you know, this happened now, and now something is happening later, and then something is happening even later on. However, you start realizing after a while that the images, as the succession of images, is actually different angles in which the artist depicted the exact same moment from very many different points of view, which is really remarkable. So he took thousands of pictures all at the same time from cameras that were fixed in different locations. He made a succession of 600 pictures that kind of unravel to the viewer as you sit there with a beautiful, you know, musical score that he created for the piece. And it's really, really a great illustration of how there's never only one point of view, that one specific moment could mean so many different things to so many different people when they're looking at it from so many different times, so different vantage points. One of the secrets of the exhibition is that we have managed to bring two seminal Picasso paintings into the show without having them leave the museums where they actually exist. And one of the artists who did this is actually Vic Muniz, who's showing us Picasso's Woman Weeping, but in a very, very different way. So the painting is actually lying on the floor, and the surface of the painting is facing the wall, so you don't actually get to see the side where the painting actually is. You see the back. And on the back, you get to see the labels, the brackets, all the signs that indicate the journey that this artwork has made from when it was first created by Picasso in the studio and all the different people who owned it, the museums that exhibited it. So in a sense, you're actually getting to see the work in a completely new way and learn a lot about where it has been and its provenance, things that you don't actually get to see when you go into a museum and you see it hanging on the wall.
We also have a number of great paintings in the exhibition, and I would like to talk briefly about the work of Kim Chang-yul, one of those great Korean masters. And he paints in a seemingly very minimal style. What is so special about these works is that he manages to paint hyper-realist drops of water. These are clearly things you would never see on a painting or a canvas. So the play of a painting where the last thing you would see and hope to see is actually a drop of water really plays with your eyes in a very powerful way. We have several very important works by him where he paints in a very kind of almost ephemeral, minimal style geometric shapes, a circle or a triangle or a square, and right next to it sits tiny little drop of water. And this dialogue of something that is more abstract and hyper-realist creates a wonderful tension that the viewer really engages in. And these drops of water shine and sparkle from a very long distance, and you really wonder how can it be that a drop of water is just hanging there and not falling. So it even plays with your understanding of space and gravity.
Kara Walker is another artist in the exhibition that tricks us into seeing things in a different way. In the film piece that we have here, we actually realize that she is using the style of children's puppet theater, shadow puppetry, to tell a specific story. And usually when you see these shapes, you think it's something, you know, entertaining, it's something light, it's something innocent, it's something fun, because it's an art form that is usually used for children. However, you realize very, very quickly as you, you know, start watching the film that the story is a very dark story of, you know, a white woman in the American South who has a love affair with a black slave, and then how the black slave is actually murdered and lynched by other members in the community, white members. So it's actually very much in line with the work that Kara Walker has been doing for a long time in critiquing and challenging, you know, racial relations, racism, black American history within, you know, her artistic practice. As we walk through this exhibition and experience all these multiple ways of seeing, we are actually reminded that looking at its core is a very political act, and that what artists do in allowing us to see the world in a different way is reminding us that there are always so many ways of seeing, and that it is so important for these different points of view to coexist.